everyone. Welcome back to week three of Oz Hoopers TV season two. This week we have on Blake Jones, one of the best scorers in the country, easily one of the best big men in his class. Very excited to have him on. Hesh, how you doing? You all right?
Good. Yep, good. Had a nice weekend. Got out of town for a little while, which was nice. But excited to talk to Blake, man.
Yeah, me too. I watched him at Nationals. Me and my mate went up. And my mate said he's by far the most natural looking scorer out there, which is pretty interesting because not many people, I feel like he's not highly regarded on some people's radar as such, but yeah, he's very talented. So keen to have him on. Let's get straight into the episode. First thing we're going to talk about is last week when we filmed the podcast, the day after, there were some NBL trades that happened, shook the league around a little bit. NZ, New Zealand released Lamar Patterson, which I felt is a bit expected. Lamar was very on and off. I think he averaged like 10. He was having a rough season with the Breakers. You could kind of see it coming. Then the Bullets released Orlando Johnson, which I've heard a lot of stuff. A lot of people with mixed opinions. Orlando was starting to pick up his game a little bit. Very defensive-minded player. Starting to score a little bit on the offense, but they decided to make the move and get rid of him. Bullets sign Lamar Patterson, bring him back after he had MVP-like seasons. And then New Zealand signed Levi Randolph, who I don't know much about. I'm still yet to see it. What are your thoughts on the moves?
Damn, there's a lot to unpack there. Let's start with Lamar Patterson. Yeah, agreed that he had an average start to the season. Obviously, numbers suggested that, but even watching him play for the Breakers, he just looked out of rhythm, out of sync, never really got a flow. I always find that you need a certain type of import to be really successful with ball-dominant guards. Like Corey Webster and Ty Webster dominate the ball so much for New Zealand. So I never really felt like Lamar Patterson came into his own. I mean, in his own control, I felt like he looked out of shape. I don't want to judge and assume, but he definitely looked a step slower, a little bit more fatigued, a little bit less spry defensively than what he did at the Bullets. So yeah, sure. Rough start and expected, I think, given what had transpired.
When they signed him, I was like, that fills Scotty Hobson's place immediately. I'm a big fan of Lamar Patterson, obviously because I'm a Bullets fan. What he did, I was surprised he left Bullets in the first place. But when he went to Breakers, I was like, that's a great pickup. But season didn't play out the way he wanted it to, and Bullets ended up picking him back up, which I've heard a lot of people talk, said it's very risky.
I think it's risky, but
I think come playoff time, I think Vic, Law, Sobey, and Lamar are three massive scorers and a lot of firepower to go against. I feel like Orlando's a great player. And he is very good defensively, but come playoff time, you might need Lamar Patterson.
I'm going to disagree, man. I would have taken Orlando Johnson over Lamar, just given the makeup of the team. I'm not trying to. Lamar Patterson is certified; like he's a bucket getter, and we know this. He's done it before. But I thought Brisbane had figured a few things out with Sobey really playing like MVP type basketball. We spoke about that last week. Vic Law compliments him perfectly. Like, you know, they feel like they've got rhythm. They got Hodgson, who's been playing well. And there's that young Kiwi center, I think. I forgot his name.
Tyrell Harrison.
Harrison. Yeah, he's been good too. Like, he's been playing a little bit more. And I felt like Orlando Johnson just was the glue. He was like locked up the other team's best player. Like, you know, he was like energy type guy. I just felt like watching Brisbane games. I was like, okay, they got a bit of rhythm there. Shocked me a little bit. I'm not going to lie.
I think Orlando was a bit of a locker room guy as well. I saw when he got released, a lot of people on Instagram, sad to see him go. Felt like he was an energy type of player. So I don't know how it's going to play out. I'm keen to see how it plays out. I hope Lamar starts to lock in and get in shape before the playoffs, because I think Bullets will be in there. So yeah. I think it's good. I don't know.
It could work. Don't get me wrong. I just think it's like you're flirting with danger a little bit. Like, you know, you had it figured out. I thought they were like, okay, one of the contenders for sure. They were like looking really good. Sobey was playing well. Now it's like, all right, they got another guard coming in who needs, you know, 15 to 16 shots a game type of thing to be effective. So how's that going to impact things? Let's see.
I think New Zealand isn't getting much recognition for their moves. It's a lot of the Bullets getting Lamar back. Is that the right move? A lot of people aren't showing a lot of attention to New Zealand. They didn't only get Levi Randolph, who I haven't seen much of, but I think he averaged like 9 or 10 a game in the G League, which is pretty impressive. They signed Jeremy Kendall, vet,
he's tough,
NBL guard, and Will McDowell White.
Yes, your boy.
Yeah, that is a huge signing. Trust me, that is a huge signing. Yeah, I don't know where they're placed on the ladder right now, but Ty, Will, Corey, that's a big three right there. And they got Levi coming in who can hopefully make an impact, but I don't know where they're placed on the ladder. I think they're like bottom two.
Yeah.
But maybe next year.
They've upgraded, man. They've upgraded with you know, a couple of those local players who are NBL caliber without doubt. Obviously, Will's been playing in the G League and Jeremy Kendall's been floating around the NBL for a while. And he's tough. Jeremy Kendall's proven. Like he didn't have like the most orthodox way. He didn't come up through the system and was just like a poster boy. He worked. Like he got picked up from Siebel, I think, when it was Siebel, and they were like, couldn't ignore this guy. Kept knocking on their doors, and then he got signed, and then he just made a name for himself in the NBL. So I think New Zealand have upgraded. I'm happy. I'm excited for them. See what they can produce.
Yeah, don't be surprised when Will McDowell comes out and drops 20 bombs. All right, I'm just letting everyone know that's going to happen. It's for sure going to happen. Second thing we're going to get into today is what's going on with the Cairns Taipans. Whew. Lost tonight to the Kings in a close one. They're now 5-game losing streak, 4-14 on the ladder, their record, sorry, and they're at the bottom of the ladder. Very talented roster. What's going on with Cairns?
No idea, man. Like you said, their roster's nice. You look at it on paper, they tick a lot of boxes and they look like they should be very competitive. It just goes to show like how I think the NBL is one of the more competitive leagues in the world in terms of any given night. I think a team can beat another team because there's most teams are packed with some bucket getters and guys that can light up. And Cairns have that. Cairns have firepower. And for some reason, it hasn't resulted in dubs. So I'm not too sure, but it's a tough season, man. Like when you go 5 in a row, anytime you lose 5 in a row, that's never going to be a happy locker room.
It's not an 80-game season either. So 5 in a row is like a lot in the NBL.
Sure.
I don't know what's going on in Cairns.
I mean, they've had a few close ones, man.
On paper, that team is very good. I just don't know.
Yeah,
I'm going to rewatch the Kings Taipans game in a minute, but
I haven't watched it. I just saw the score. They lost by 2. They've had a couple of, from memory, just I can't document all their games, but it seems like they've had a lot of close ones, man. Which is tough, I guess. You win some, you lose some, but I don't know. Are they going to stay strong with their roster and continue to push through, or are they going to make some changes, you reckon?
I did. Well, I got no clue. You'd think very soon if they are, or they're just going to play the season out too late,
yeah.
I guess. Try and make some moves next season.
Yeah.
I think they're missing DJ Newbill a bit.
Yeah, he was tough. He was a buck getter, and he was defensively very solid.
Next, this week, I was back in Sydney, caught up with Hesh a bit. I got the chance to film Shyla Hill. At the next month, mid next month, she's projected to be a top 15, top 12 pick in the WNBA draft. Have you seen Shyla play?
I have seen snippets, never seen her play live. Seen some highlight tape, seen some game tape. And she is tough. She is nice, man. Like she can stroke it. She's control with the ball, decision-making with the ball. She looks like she's a vet.
Yeah, she's really good. I went to a workout with her and her dad, Shane Hill, you know, Aussie legend. And the training was good. It was a very interesting training session. At one point they were doing floaters from like beyond free throw. And I was like, what's going on here? But she was knocking them down like so consistently. I was like, wow. Like Tyler Harvey's doing that as well, those floaters from, you know.
I think floaters are like a necessary shot for guards to have, no doubt. I mean, it's just, I guess it's just like everything. It just kind of changes over time. And now it's like if you can knock it down at a high percentage, why not shoot it, man? Like,
Dallas has 5 picks in the first round. I know New York has a pick and Chicago has a pick as well. So next month, I think April 16, the WNBA draft is happening. Okay. So everyone tune in for that. She killed it in the WNBL as well. She played for Townsville Fire.
Saw some of her numbers, man. She lit the league, especially down the court. She killed it.
She had some massive – there was a semifinals game, and I'm like, she might have, like, you know, 15, big game. She's dropping, like, 30 bombs against Liz Cambage. I don't know. 19 years old. Doing that in the Australian league.
I think she started her professional career or semi-professional career at like 14 or something.
Something ridiculous.
In the bloodline, man, like, you know, her dad was a no fear type of guy. Like, he would just take on anybody. He had that kind of like, you know, tough mentality, gritty mentality. And obviously was exceptionally skilled and, you know, genetically just passed that on, I guess, to the next one.
I think Charlotte's one of the most hyped girls coming out of Australia in a long time.
Mm-hmm.
I think she has really good potential. I'm keen to see her play.
Liz stands out to me. Obviously, she was.
Liz was big. But
yeah, and obviously before that, it was Lauren. What's her name? Lauren Jackson.
Lauren Jackson.
Yeah, Lauren Jackson. I think she was huge as well. She got MVP a couple of times in WNBA. I mean, I would say she's the most hyped for sure.
Yeah, I agree. Another young gun I want to talk about, since we haven't really spoken much about them on the podcast, is Tyrese Proctor. I know he's a Sydney kid. Have you seen him play? What are your thoughts on his game?
Same thing. I'm yet to see him play live. I'd like to. I've seen a lot of tape of him. I've seen some mixtapes. I've seen some footage as well. And he is, smooth, super, super smooth offensively. Looks like he plays in gears and he doesn't get flustered and rushed. Just got a smoothness to him that I really like. I think it's easy on the eyes, you know, to just watch him play. Looks effortless for him. So I'm impressed. Want to obviously get to know him a little bit more and find out what he's about.
Yeah, his game's insane. I went and filmed him in Sydney not long ago, and he was coming down half court and like he was stepping over half court and like pump faking, and the defenders were jumping. And I was like, what is going on? And then eventually he started stepping over and popping them and hitting them, and no one was reacting. Like, everyone was running back. And I was looking around going like, is this normal? Like, what's going on here? Like, is this every week or I don't know. But yeah, he's insane. He got picked for the Tall Blacks game.
I saw that.
He's very young as well. Very young. He's down at the academy right now. So,
what is he, 02?
Good question. No, younger than that.
03, 04.
03, 04, maybe 04.
Okay. Yeah,
Tyrese, if you're listening, come on the show. We're keen to have you on.
Definitely.
Yeah.
I reached out to him to work him out.
Yeah.
He said he's got a really busy schedule at the moment. Yeah, obviously, he's excellent and all that. But yeah, no, I'd love for him to come on the show, man, pick his brain on a few things.
Yeah, I got the chance to meet him. He's a cool guy. Yeah. Come on the show, bro. We're keen to have you on. We're going to get Blake Jones on in a minute. Keen to have him on. See what's up. Yo. I'm making a change today. The liquor been taking the pain away. I heard you was giving your chain away. That's kind of like giving your fame away. What's wrong with you? I sit in a box where the owners do. A boss is a role that I've grown into. I love you to death, but I told you the truth. I can't just be with you, I'm only you. Yeah, I got one Virgil, got one in that dance. The only two, man. How many times have I shown and proved, man? How many nights I've been woke, swerving the potholes. What's up, Blake? How you going?
Good, thanks. How are you guys?
Yeah, not too bad. Just want to introduce Hesh. He'll be co-hosting the show with us today.
How you doing, Blake?
Good, thanks, bro. How are you?
Good, man. Good.
Thanks for coming on the show. We appreciate it. We saw you went on for the Bullets last night, which is really good. 19 years old. Let's get into the whole. We'll get into the whole Bullets experience later on. Let's start with your younger life and getting into basketball. How did you firstly get into basketball?
Well, for me, my sister played, actually. I didn't play when I was younger, but she played, and then my parents were like, hey, well, we're taking her to basketball. Do you want to come along as well? So I was like, all right, yeah, may as well. I'll give it a try. And then, yeah, going on since then.
What age was that?
About under 10, so it would have been like eight or so.
Okay. I seen you're 6'8".
6'9".
6'9".
Okay. You're right. 6'9". Every inch counts, man.
Yeah, don't get it wrong. When did your growth spurt occur? When did you shoot up?
I've always been like pretty tall. I'd say like always kind of one of the tall kids around. So yeah, it's always kind of been like that.
I'm personally a big fan of your game. What do you think right now is one part of your game that you think you need to work on?
For me, it's kind of just creating my own shot, you know, off the dribble, playing off the bounce, being able to do that.
Have you always, you said you were a tall kid, like since you were young. Did you always play the big man position?
No, like under 10s, I was kind of played a bit of point guard. Grew a bit after that and grew out of that. But yeah, so that's kind of where I started, being able to handle from like a young age, and then got bigger and still being able to like maintain that ball handling.
You're trying to work on expanding the repertoire a little bit off the bounce. Where are you most comfortable right now on the floor? Do you like it like from the perimeter with the ball in your hand, live dribble, or you kind of like,
you know? Yeah, from the perimeter, that's definitely, you know, what I'm working on the most. Like CJ Bruton up here with the Bullets, like putting a lot of work in with him. One of the legends, the best to do it really at that kind of stuff. So yeah, he's been helping a lot with that.
Yeah, CJ's a good coach. When around did you join the NBA Academy?
Would have been middle of 2018.
Okay. Yeah. What was the recruitment process like? Because I know a lot of these guys get into the NBA Academy. I'm just wondering what like the recruitment process is sort of like. Like, how do they go about it?
Yeah, well, so for me, I went to Albert Schweitzer in 2018, that tournament in Germany.
Okay.
So I was lucky enough to go on that Doug Water Mage, and then played in that, and then had 18s Bottom Age Nationals. Yeah. And then from that, like a week or two later, got a call from Capes, and basically just offered me a spot down there on the spot on the phone.
Was it a hard decision?
Nah, definitely not. Nah.
Okay.
It was. Yeah,
what was it like transitioning from, you know, Queensland to Canberra? Were you?
Because I'm originally from Canberra, so it was basically, yeah, going back home for me, not living at home, but yeah, back in the hometown. So it was easy transition for me.
Where has all that taken you across the world?
Oof. So been to America 5 or 6 times, like Atlanta, Minnesota, Vegas, Chicago, and Germany, Argentina with like national team stuff, New Caledonia, and then Barcelona as well, started last year. That was the kind of the most recent one before everything got shut down.
What was your best trip performance wise?
Well, Oceania champs, I'd say, but
yeah,
I don't know if that really counts with the kind of the competition that we were playing against.
I saw you went on one of the trips to Atlanta and you had 18 points, which is massive. What were the scouts like at that comp? Did anyone approach you or?
Where was this?
The Atlanta comp in Atlanta.
I think you had 18. Yeah, I got a bit of interest after that. Like there was gym, it was full of coaches and scouts at that. So yeah, got a few texts from coaches.
Earlier this week, you got announced to Queensland, the team. I watched you last Nationals We unfortunately came second. Obviously, I'm going for Queensland because I'm from Queensland. But yeah, you were massive in the final game. Played well throughout the tournament. What were you thinking when Josh put up that final shot?
Yeah. I thought it was going in, to be honest. That first,
yeah, did.
Yeah, well, first of all, I thought, man, I shouldn't have switched that screen. Like, yeah. They obviously ran that. They knew we were going to switch. They wanted Giddy a ISO with whoever else was on him. And then it went up, and I'm under the bus. I was just trying to box out. And then I remember just bouncing straight back to him. And then, yeah, I knew he got a second look. That wasn't
Was that the coverage? Was the coverage to switch it?
Yeah. We talked about that going in, switch all ball screens and that. And then
didn't want to fight over the top, get out of his hands.
Yeah, well, after the thought, I was like, damn, I really shouldn't have switched that. Like, they didn't really set the screen. It was just all cloud and smoke to try and get me off Giddy. But, yeah.
It's a massive gut punch since you guys did so well throughout the tournament. I think the play before that, might have been the play before that, but you hit a massive three. Yeah. It was like coming off like something, and I think you were like semi-fading and you hit a three. And I was like, yeah, like that's it. It's over. But, yeah.
Tough.
What are your thoughts on the current 20s team that just got announced?
I haven't really we had a camp on the weekend, but I was down in Melbourne for the hub, so I didn't get to see that. But I think we'll have a strong team. We got a lot of bottom majors, a lot of young guys, and guys that like missed out on 18s nationals last year, so it'll be like their first nationals for a lot of them, so it'll be an experience and a lot of ups and downs, but I think, you know, we've got a good team and we're looking to medal again.
Sounds like you've got a young team, and obviously your experience, is that leadership role something that you gravitate towards pretty naturally?
Yeah, definitely. I think I've been around the world and had all the experiences for someone of this age, so definitely something trying to mentor those young guys in our team, especially ones who haven't played in nationals before, haven't played at that level either.
Yeah, I think it's going to be a good run for you guys. You got a lot of, I think, Boston and Preston at the one and two, very strong guard positions. You down low, I think you guys will put up, you know, a good fight. Let's get into your Australian teams. When was your first Australian team announcement? Was it under 17s or earlier?
Yeah, 17s, World Cup,
2018. Maybe. I dominated the comp. Averaged 15 points, second most on the team, behind Giddy, and you guys won the gold. Talk about that overall experience.
Oh, that was it was an experience, like living conditions, and that kind of wasn't that great. But it was just a lot of adversity we had to go through that week as a team. But I thought like we played really well. We all came together, and just getting that exposure to, like, international basketball again. I thought that was really big one, and just getting out there with mates and playing.
What do you mean by living experiences that week?
Well, we were stuck in like a New Caledonian boarding school type thing, and like there was no hot water. It was like seven guys in a room. Like the toilet seats didn't have, there was no toilet seats, like cold shower. Yeah. It was, yeah, so a lot of as Bwali would say, the trenches.
Yeah. do you remember where you were and what your reaction was to getting picked for the Oceania team?
Yeah, it was we had AusCamp at the Institute, and the selection meetings. So everyone's in one room, and then one by one, each person gets called out to have a meeting with the coaches. And yeah, my name's called, went into meeting with Mark Radford, our head coach, with Cass, and then they let me know I made the team, so you know, it's pretty over the moon. I mean, like, any chance you get to represent a country like that, such an honor and a privilege, and yeah, it was pretty exciting.
We heard about Mark Radford from Rain, so yeah. We'll get into the Bullets. What was the recruiting process for that like? Did they invite you to a training camp or?
Yeah, so we came up here, like the COE group, we came up here in, I want to say, August, September, around then, and we played a scrimmage against the Bullets, and after that, I spoke with Sam McKinnon, GM up here, and he was asking me like what my plans were for the next 6 to 12 months, and I said, you know, I'd love to be part of the NBL and, you know, join a team in a development spot like that, and then we kind of just moved forward from there and got it sorted.
What was your initial reaction when he asked you to join? Were you hesitant, or were you like, yep, straight away?
No, I was pretty much like straight away, yeah, that's like where I want to be, you know. Being back, like, went to school up here, you know, friends and family all up here, so you know, come back here, and you know, it was a great opportunity. I was like, yeah, take that straight away.
It's interesting because, like, I find a lot of people, like the elite guys of your age bracket, it's a mixed response about college and trying to get straight onto the NBL. Was college ever like an option for you, or did that float through your head?
Yeah, no. So I'm still planning on going to college, like this year, middle of this year. Haven't decided where I'm going to go. Like, still trying to figure that out. But I thought, you know, I'd be able to, you know, come train with the pro team for the NBL season and get that exposure with pros. And I thought that would, you know, best put me in the best way, you know, in preparation for college and to, you know, take that next jump into college.
Yeah, definitely the right choice, I reckon. Work with an NBL team and then head into college, make an impact. Have you had any visits to any colleges, or what are the offers looking like, if you are able to tell us, or?
Well, no, so no visits, everything's, you know, shut down. So, can't get out there. So, you know, it's kind of making it tough, trying to, you know, sort it out and figure out where you want to go. And, like with COVID and everything's kind of, been shut down a little bit, and like seniors get their years back. And so yeah, it's kind of a bit slow at the moment. We're just, I'm just waiting out and seeing what, comes up really.
What is the overall experience been like training with these Bullets guys?
Man, it's been great. Like, it's just a whole nother level, whole nother league. Like, you think it won't be that much difference, but like every day it's just a grind. Like going against like Sobey, like those, like Vic Law, like NBA type talents there. Like, it's just, it's unbelievable.
Who would you say has been the biggest in your ear sort of guy, giving you the most advice and stuff like that?
For me, it was actually Orlando Johnson. You know, we built quite a tight, you know, all close friends and good relationship there. And, yeah, kind of sad to see him move on. But, yeah.
Yeah, we mentioned.
What's the best bit of advice that Orlando gave you?
It was just kind of stay ready, you know, bide your time. And right now you might be not getting that court time, but, you know, you just got to stick with it and trust like the work you're putting in and trust the people around you that they're putting you in the best position to succeed. And he's got this motto that he goes by, it's, you know, to attack life and attack everything you do. And that's kind of something that I've kind of, you know, taken under my wing and tried to implement myself.
Yeah, we mentioned early in this episode that Orlando was a massive locker room guy, and I feel like half, like a lot of the Bullets players were saddened to see him go, which, yeah, might, you know, leave an effect on the Bullets. A lot of people were questioning the moves they made. You got Lamar Patterson in. What was your reaction when you saw that news?
Well, you know, like, awesome to have Lamar, you know, back in Brisbane. Like, we all know what type of player he is, and you know, we're just looking forward to getting him back on the court. And I think, you know, bringing him in, it's going to put us in a real real good shape to, you know, make finals and push for that championship, really. Ultimately, that's, like, what we're trying to do. And that's what we think is going to be the best way to get the job done. So, yeah, I'm excited, looking forward to getting him back on the floor.
I saw, I think it was All Schools in Melbourne. I saw you had, what was it, Hesh?
What was it, 32 and 18 or something? Something ridiculous. I don't know.
38.
Like,
ridiculous numbers, man. What's your average for the tournament?
It was like, would have been close to 30 and like 16 rebounds or something like that.
That's wild.
What's the school that you won with? The school in Canberra? Or
Lake Legendary College.
Yeah. I thought you did school at AIS. Or is that?
Yeah, so I did. Yeah, I did year, like half year 11 and year 12 at Lake G in Canberra.
Okay.
Lake,
Was there any teams that came close, or was your team pretty stacked?
We're pretty stacked. Like Hunter Clark, he was the other first guy, and he's another like local Canberra guy. So it was pretty much like a full Canberra team, honestly. Like me being from Canberra, Hunter's from Canberra, and then a bunch of the other guys like Dahl Fieg. Like weird, you know, a real good team, and kind of breeze through the tournament.
That's pretty sick to know that you're the best school in the country.
Real quick, what you got planned for the future, Blake? What's aspirations, goals? What do you want to get out of your career?
Well, obviously the NBA, like that's main goal for every kid growing up. And for me, college is the next step in my journey, and then do however many years there, and then kind of see where it takes me after that. You know, professionally overseas, that's something I'm interested in, like Europe, playing over there. But yeah, that's kind of like the goal.
I mean, it's exciting, I guess, for you, because like we're getting, you know, Mo King and Giddy both getting some NBA hype. And, you know, they're both in the NBL right now as young guys. So it's like the pathway is there for you, man. So
Exactly. It's coming through. Like 5, 10 years ago, you don't really see guys going straight from the NBL to the NBA. But now, you know, it's definitely a realistic pathway for like juniors all around Australia.
Definitely.
All right. We're going to get into the 10 quick questions. Who's your favorite player of all time and why?
Favorite player, Kobe Bryant. I just, grew up watching him in the Lakers, and rest in peace, the Mamba. But just like his competitiveness and just unmatched, like seeing him out on the court, you know, it's pretty unbelievable, honestly. Like the way he just goes at it every single game, every single possession, like that's something really I admire.
Sure. What about yourself? Who's the hardest player you've ever had to guard individually?
Nathan Sobey, for sure.
Extremely
hard.
We ask this every week. Celebrity crush.
Summer Rae.
Yeah, another quick one.
Dude, these young guys are ready in the head. Rain last week. Who did he say last week?
Zendaya. Going like that.
Dude, you guys answer that question quicker than any other question, man.
Man, don't even think about that one, man.
Yeah, true.
What about, here's a controversial one. Who's the worst state of basketball in Australia?
Worst state? Man, I don't want to throw anyone under the bus here. I guess, you know, by performance, you'd have to say Northern Territory, but...
Yeah, that's fair enough.
I don't have a lot of guys playing up there, and you know, access to facilities and that. So, but
good answer. De'Aaron Fox or John Wall?
I go De'Aaron Fox. I think he's younger, hasn't had any injuries. I think he's got a bright future ahead of him. John Wall's kind of, you know, battling some injuries at the moment and still coming back from that. But I think, De'Aaron Fox, if you're building a team around someone right now, it's going to be De'Aaron Fox.
Yeah. He is hooping, man. He's playing out of his skin right now.
I respect that answer.
Mm-hmm. Okay, next question. Man, you got me asking all the hate questions. Most overrated player in the NBA, Blake?
In the NBA?
Overrated.
Overrated. Man.
Wait, Hesh, who do you think is the most overrated?
I'll go first. Personally, and this is not, I don't want to like, there's obviously misconception about when you say someone's overrated, it doesn't mean you think that they're not good.
Yeah.
First, I want to just make sure that's the first thing. So the person I'm saying I think is absolutely amazing, but I think he gets a little bit too much hype. Giannis, man.
I can see that, yeah.
Yeah, I think Giannis.
A two-time MVP.
I know, but that's the same people that overrate him. Gave him that award.
I don't know.
Rob LeBron of MVP last year, so.
Yeah, that's a fact. And Harden the year before that.
Yeah.
But I don't know. I think, I don't know. I don't want to hate on the Raptors, but I think Siakam is very overrated. And I think Kyle Lowry is very overrated. But no hate to the Raptors. But yeah, I don't know. Not that they're bad, and they definitely are a good team, and they obviously win games. But I just think player for player, I just think Kyle Lowry and Siakam are rated better than some of the other players in their position. That's my answer. What about you, Blake? What do you reckon?
Yeah, I think Siakam, I kind of agree with that one there. He kind of gets a bit obviously like great player, but
I'm just not sure about his play style, you know.
Kind of in between positions, and
it's always hard. The overrated question is always tough because it's like, it's just like, what are you comparing to? Like, you know, and it's like people just get hyped for anything these days, you know.
Yeah,
I've heard you guys say Zion overrated. Just on pure basketball skill, people say, you know, he kind of just uses athleticism and bullies guys and doesn't actually have that much, you know, basketball skill. But
That's interesting, because I think that's the other part of the question. It's like, what are you actually rating? Are you just rating their effectiveness, or is it like their skill set, or, you know?
Yeah, he's a really effective player, but like, basketball skill wise, like, interesting.
I tell you one thing though, nobody wants to guard Zion. I'll tell you that.
No chance, bro. You won't be catching me anywhere near him.
Bro, crazy.
This is a controversial one as well. Sorry about hitting you with these ones, but you're starting a team and you're the captain. So you're picking someone to play alongside you, and they have to be 0-2 born. Who are you picking and why?
That's tough. I mean, I gotta go Giddy. I think love playing with him. Like, he finds you when you need the ball, and like he can just impact the game in so many different ways. Like, 6'8" point guard can play multiple positions. I think, he's kind of the guy that you'd want to start your team with.
Yeah, it's dope. I mean, I can see that. All right, what about, let's throw some love out there. Who do you mold your game after, man? Like, who do you look at and you try and, you know, learn from or watch and try and imitate?
I watch a lot of Kevin Durant, kind of, you know, how he creates his shots and uses his, like, size and length, and, you know, not the strongest guy out there, but still able to get to his spots and that. And same with kind of like Brandon Ingram, another guy like that, kind of uses his length and athleticism and finesse kind of to get through people and get to his own shots. They're kind of two guys that I've been looking at.
What is the best takeaway food, in your opinion?
Takeaway? I love Mexican. I'm a big Mexican fan.
You going Guzman? Yes, sir.
That's dope. All right. Here we go. Another one that we ask everybody at the end of the 10 questions. Personalized, but it's to I want to get a specific answer of you. I'm hoping I get it. Who's the best big man in the country?
In like what age group?
Let's go your age bracket and below.
My age, big man. I mean, I don't really classify myself as a big man.
Right.
If we're talking like pure, if we're talking pure big man,
No, not pure big man. Not pure big man. All right, let's do this. Let's go. The best guy over 6'6".
I'm taking myself then. Of course I'm taking myself, man.
Yes.
That's the answer I want to hear, Blake.
Now we're going to get into 5 fan questions. We chuck these up on our stories for our followers to ask you. The first one is, what's a basketball shoe that you got and you didn't like wearing? That's an interesting one. I haven't heard that one before.
Didn't like. Man, that's a tough one. I mean, I had, that's got me good.
You usually wear all your shoes out. They usually do the job.
Yeah, they all just kind of get the job done, to be honest.
Yeah, all right, we'll do nil. We'll say none.
What about in this new experience in the pros, what's a normal day in the life like for you as a Bullets player?
So we'll have like weights start like 7:45 to like 8:45, and then have like time to get ready. We'll do like individual workouts from like 9 to 10, and then we'll have like a team training from say 10 to 11:30, and then we'll have like extra time, you know, if you want to grab a coach, you know, get extra work in, extra shots, and then kind of be like film study and scout like after training, and then kind of the rest of the day is like yours, do what you want. You can come back, get extra work in, extra shots up, like whenever you want. Yeah, that's pretty much like most days.
You've obviously had a lot of coaching experience, school, rep, nationals, club, COE, Bullets. Who's been your favorite coach?
Favorite coach? I mean, Marty Clark has been kind of one of the most, he's probably one of like most influential, like best coaches I've had. Like joining the academy kind of at a young age, he was really instrumental in me kind of, you know, developing as a player. And yeah, I think he's probably one of the guys that has helped me a lot, you know, along my way.
Nice. All right. Favorite basketball moment in your entire career?
One favorite moment. That's tough. I'd say winning the tournament in Barcelona. That was with the NBA Academy. That was pretty special. Like we came up against Barcelona in the final, and like we were underdogs. No one expected us to win, and we ended up, you know, beating them in the final. And over there in Barcelona, it's like they had the home crowd, home fans, pretty hostile environment, and yeah, like getting the job done over there, that was pretty special.
And last one, who's the funniest player on the Bullets?
On the Bullets. Oh, Vic Law. He's a funny guy.
Thanks for coming on the show, Blake. It means a lot. We wish you luck in the future. March Madness is currently happening, so, you know, it's getting me excited for college basketball and seeing these guys come up and making it. So, yeah, I'm keen to see you out there killing it. Yeah, good luck, bro, and thanks for coming on.
Hey, can I also say, Mo King did me dirty last time he came on here saying that the worst drip and shoot. Yeah. I don't want to say that. That's not true, Mo. Like, Mo can't talk about drip, you know. He can't talk. We'll just say that.
I like that.
Mo King has to respond now, all right?
Yeah. I want to hear what he says about that. Yeah.
Thanks. Appreciate it. Appreciate your time, Blake. Really do.
Thanks, fellas.
Thanks, everyone, for watching. We appreciate it. Stay tuned for next week. We've got a very special guest. Yeah, see you next week.